tomorrow. And much big ups to Dev Ross at the controls. Thank you for calling 1-800-439-5732.
You are faced with dozens of choices every day. Here's another choice that we're asking you to make right now. It's a choice that can make a difference to thousands of people throughout our community. It's a choice that can put great radio on your dial every day of the week. You choose to listen to KPFA. Now choose to support it. Every gift that is received will help us spend less time fundraising. Visit kpfa.org to give securely online. Thanks. You're listening to KPFA 94.1 in Berkeley, KPFB 89.3 in Berkeley, KFCF 88.1 in Fresno.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program for the final day of the KPFA Fund Drive, we're going to blow the roof off the 21st century. We speak with author and communication scholar Dr. Robert McChesney. We'll talk political economy. We'll also share excerpts of the late Howard Zinn, some special interviews that he did for Project Censored, the movie ending the reign of junk food news. Please stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program, blowing the roof off the 21st century, media, politics, and the struggle for post-capitalist democracy. We're joined by Professor Robert McChesney, who also share with you excerpts from extended interviews with historian Howard Zinn that are part of Project Censored, the movie, ending the reign of junk food news. Robert McChesney is the Gutzel Endowed Professor in the Department of Communication at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. He's the author of several books on media, including the award-winning Rich Media, Poor Democracy and Communication Revolution, and co-editor with Victor Packard of Will the Last Reporter Please Turn Out the Lights, all available on the New Press. His most recent book with Monthly Review is Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century. Robert McChesney, thank you so much for joining us on the Project Censored Show today.
It's a pleasure, Mickey.
Please tell us, what's the title of the book implying here, and what are people getting into in your new book, Blowing the Roof Off of the 21st Century?
Well, I didn't want to have my 87th book with the title of Media, Politics, and Power or something like some combination of words that previously get empty the ninth time you've used the same combination of words. So that was one motivation. But really, the argument I'm making in the book, and certainly in the core chapters, the beginning and the end, is that we're in a very dynamic period right now. I mean, all periods of history, I guess, are dynamic. But we can see around us right now there are tremendous pressure points. And something's got to give. The nature of our society is under extraordinary social, economic, and environmental stress. And it's going to be very difficult for anything remotely close to democracy to survive. And it's going to be a very difficult period that's going to require radical social change. And it's going to come. The only question is, what type of social change will it be, for the better or for the worse? And I think it's in all our interest that it be social change that leads to a radical reconstruction of society to make it more equitable, more free, more democratic, and more humane and environmentally sustainable.
Robert McChesney, it's Peter Phillips. I wanted to ask you, you write about the Nader presidential campaign in 2000. You write about popular uprisings in 2011 and the willingness of, as you say, young people to really question the nature of capitalism and where people think we need to go. Is this realistic in this century?
Oh, absolutely. It's realistic. For one thing, and something I put in the introduction to the book, I think one of the issues I deal with in the book, and I deal with in all my writing now and all my talks, and let's get it right out front, is we've got to get away, I think, all of us from something I think must be part of human nature, is that we look at the situation we're in right now, the world we're in, and we look at yesterday and the day before, and we assume that tomorrow and the day after are going to be just what we have today and yesterday. And, of course, history doesn't work that way. Nothing would have ever changed if that was how the world operated. In fact, it's quite the opposite. We know we're going to have radical change. It's just very hard for us to understand what it's going to be, but it hasn't taken place yet. We never can anticipate in advance. And in the beginning of the book, Peter, I give the story of a professor I had in graduate school at the University of Washington who was a white South African, but he came to the United States in the 1960s. He was opposed to apartheid. All his family still remained in Cape Town. And he worked at the ANC. He studied the anti-apartheid movement. And when I left Seattle to go to Madison for my first teaching job in 1988, I went into his office to say goodbye. And he was very morose. He was sad. And I said, "What's wrong, Tony?" And he said, "Well, I've been talking to all his comrades, all his friends in South Africa in the movement, and they'd never been so depressed. I said, it'd be impossible to have peaceful transition to power in South Africa. The Afrikaans government refused to negotiate. He said there would be so much bloodshed to get justice for black Africans in South Africa, it would make the country uninhabitable for anyone for a century." And I later learned that that opinion was widespread in the anti-apartheid movement, the ANC. It was a very gloomy period. This was May of 1988. Well, 2 years later, after the most authoritative person I knew in South Africa made this pronouncement to me, 2 years after that, Nelson Mandela was released from Robben Island Prison. 4 years after that, he was elected president of South Africa. And in that intervening 6 years, there was less violence than you'd seen in a New Jersey bar fight on a Saturday night. So the point of this, the moral of the story, and the reason why this is important for people to understand is that the smartest people in the world, the most engaged people in the world working on the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, the moment before the revolution was going to succeed, were completely wrong. They had no idea it was coming. They didn't anticipate it. They had the gloomiest possible outlook. And that's something I keep with me. And I remember stuff Howard Zinn, who I know you both are very familiar with and, like myself, learned a great deal from. But Howard Zinn used to say, he said, look, no one saw the civil rights movement coming before it came. And no one was walking around in 1952 saying, hey, 10 years from now, someone's going to have a dream. That didn't happen. No one saw it coming. No one saw any social movement coming before it came, or else it would have come back when they saw it in the first place. And we have to keep that in mind. We can't predict the future. We can't anticipate the future.
Bob, you talk about very optimistically the inevitability of a post-capitalist democracy. And, you know, of course, Howard Zinn, you lead off with his quote, you can't be neutral on a moving train. The train's moving. We don't always know where we are. And that's certainly part of what the capitalist elite want us to believe. The Occupy movement scared them. The police state infiltrated almost every organization in the country during the Occupy movement, and it did leave us with the mantra of the 99.1% in everybody's mind. So it's like we're ready for real democracy from the grassroots up. And what would be some of the signs that you would see leading us in that direction?
Well, I think you just mentioned one, Occupy. Occupy now is sort of looked at, if not nostalgically, certainly whimsically, something that was a one-off, sort of a weird fluke no one can really quite explain. I think rather the way you framed it, Peter, is the right way. I think if you look at Occupy, what it was is that when sort of a crack in the facade is bust open, you have a torrent, a flood of human anger and passion that rises up and goes through that crack, as you saw in Occupy. And I think the polling data shows this, too. I mean, the polling data, and I'm very skeptical about these, the polls, because what you ask oftentimes determines what you find and how you ask it. But the BBC and Pew and some other institutions have been doing annual polls of young people and people's attitudes towards politics and economics now for years and years and decades. And they saw a sharp shift over the last 10 or 15 years that really escalated by the end of the last decade, in which young people in particular were far more critical of capitalism. The term capitalism no longer evokes sort of a positive, squishy image of freedom and happiness and consumer shopping frenzy. Instead, capitalism was regarded in a very dubious and quite critical and increasingly negative manner by all Americans, but especially Americans under the age of 30. And in fact, the BBC data shows that in polling that capitalism is no more popular than socialism as a term for people under 30 in poll after poll. Now, what's striking about this is no one knows anything about socialism in the United States. It's not taught anywhere. The only time you hear about it is really when Fox News or some politician criticizes it for being horrible. And so people, young people are picking socialism not because they know much about it, but they just know it isn't capitalism. So it's got to be better, because the real world of capitalism, not the fairy tale that politicians and pundits and mainstream economists talk about, but rather the real world of corporate monopolies, price gouging, rip-off, lousy jobs, no unions, no protection, absolutely corrupt governance where it's controlled and dominated by the wealthy few. That real world young people are living through, and they know that is no future for them. So they just opt for whatever plan B is in that situation. To me, that's very revealing about the troubles in our times. And it's also a sign that, you know, what this system is on much more fragile ground than I think people realize. Its continued success is far more up in the air than it has been in my lifetime. And that includes the 1960s or 70s.
We're speaking with Professor Robert McChesney, author of numerous books on media, political economy. His newest book, a collection of many writings on vast topics, is titled Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, Media, Politics, and the Struggle for Post-Capitalist Democracy. So it's certainly an ambitious book, and also, Bob, a lot of optimism throughout. And the first chapter, America, I Do Mind Dying, that kind of starts to set the stage for what you get into, particularly, you know, your critique of capitalism.
I start the book by saying, look, here's a long-range trends, long-run trends that are taking place in America and to varying degrees worldwide, but especially in the United States. We're seeing, you know, vast increases in economic inequality and poverty. And I know, I'm sure in this program, you probably talked about Thomas Piketty's book, The French Economist, which pretty much showed empirically that growing inequality is built into capitalism, and that capitalism, when it goes through a slow growth phase like we're in right now, increasingly resembles feudalism. The people at the top of it with most money are people who basically inherited their wealth and are protecting their privileges. So we're living that. We're living what Piketty described. But he said it's built right into capitalism. It's not just a fluke. Secondly, all of our leading political scientists, I shouldn't say all of them, but I should say several of them, from Berkeley, from Stanford, from Michigan, from Princeton, from University of Virginia, have been doing studies of how power operates in the United States in the last 10 or 20 years, who influences the government, the federal government and state government, so that it makes decisions on fundamental policies that affect the American people, on economics, on trade, on foreign policy. And what all the studies have found, without exception, the three great studies that have been published in the last 3 years, is that virtually all the important decisions that are made in the United States are made to represent the interests of what Peter called the 1% of those at the very top, and that the interests, values, concerns of the great bulk of the population have absolutely no effect whatsoever on government. In effect, we have a plutocracy, or what John Nichols and I have called a dollarocracy, where those with money basically own the board, and those without any money don't have any role whatsoever. We're not a democracy in any functional sense. And then the third great trend that's going on is the environmental trend, the crisis we see with the climate, and there are even other issues beyond climate, but climate sort of the game changer. If we don't have an atmosphere, we're not going to be around too long. You know, you put these three things together, they're not getting better. They're only getting worse. They're not going away. And they define very much the immediate world all of us live in, and all our children will live in, our students and our friends and their children. You know, it's really a cauldron. It's not something that can last forever. Something's got to give. Something it is giving. It's in the process of giving. So I argue that that's the framework to understand it. And people say, well, how can you be an optimist? You just described a situation where things are getting worse and the people in power have control over the government. My optimism comes from a number of different sources, but one of them is that because so much of my research is studying large corporations, studying how they handle politics, studying what they're doing. And what I learned early on and see repeated over and over is how the corporations that set up all the lobbying in Washington, that set up all these groups like ALEC and all these front groups, they're in fear of democracy. They're petrified at the idea of having a high voter turnout in non-gerrymandered elections in the United States, where there were real choices in the ballot. In the last 40 years, capitalist interests, corporate interests, have been working incessantly to make this as undemocratic a country as possible. So people with as much money as they want, they can spend it all to influence elections. They want to repress the vote in places where they can't win an election, even with a low voter turnout. They want to make it even lower, make it harder for people who are considered not sufficiently happy with capitalism to vote. We see all sorts of mechanisms to make it very hard to vote, to make it very hard for people to participate. We're seeing our media system, which was never any great shakes to begin with. We turn towards ever more sewage in terms of journalism. You put all that together and you see how much fear there is at the top And you say, they're scared of something. Well, what are they scared of? They're scared of the fact they know that they don't have the numbers on their side. They can't win a fair fight. And to me, that's very empowering.
Bob, you're right here. Democracy's under capital. You don't say that, but democracy's been reduced to powerless people rooting for their favorite billionaire or corporate lobby to advance their values and interests, hoping that such a billionaire exists and they get lucky. Doesn't that sound like an oligarchy? I mean, you certainly lay that out. And if we look at this, not just in terms of the U.S., I mean, part of the fights in the Ukraine are between various capitalist billionaires. Billionaires are ruling China. Billionaires are greatly in power in Russia. This is transnational. And so are we really talking about a global transformation?
Unquestionably. And most of these essays were U.S.-based. So the focus of the book, for that reason, I made U.S.-centric. But the arguments are, you know, you have to qualify everything as you go to different countries that have different specific conditions. But the basic themes and arguments are true worldwide, certainly about the environment, certainly about capitalism and inequality, and certainly about corruption of government. These are worldwide phenomena.
Bob McChesney, in part one of your book, Putting the Politics Back in Political Economy, I actually teach a course on political economy, but it's interesting that a number of years ago that the title of the course changed from Political Economy of Democracy to Money, Power, and Politics. I think it was maybe a sexier title to get people to come in without their eyes glazing over. But what's interesting is the first night of class, I explained to them just generically what do we mean by political economy of democracy, and the whole course goes through and outlines, and again, many of the things that you have here in this section are things that certainly come up. And even though it's certainly a semester's worth of outlining some of the key challenges we face, in each segment, it's also quite optimistic. And as you yourself said, it actually isn't difficult to be optimistic about this, given history and given the history of social change and given the fact that we do have ebb and flow. So despite the fact that we have an oligarchic political series of institutions in the United States, there have been serious periods of change. And even if reform maybe is tepid for people that want radical change, we certainly have had it. I wanted to go into a little bit, open this can of worms here. Peter was just mentioning, too, the fact that we have a political system dominated by not just millionaires, but billionaires, right? And you alluded to Alec and that Osiris is connected to Koch brothers and this kind of thing. We're now facing, and of course, the corporate news media's horse race coverage. We're always looking for the next election. It's Clinton 2.0, Bush 3.0, 2016. It's already out of the gate that this is the foregone conclusion of who Americans might get to select. You know, this last election, we saw about a 37% turnout nationally. That seems like people are quite cynical about the choices. But you start talking about the Nader campaign of 2000. And again, I know that's a can of worms for some, certainly on the left in the U.S. or among progressives, I might say. So what is your long view from the Nader campaign, you say, the future of U.S. left electoral politics? Certainly Hillary Clinton doesn't represent left electoral politics.
Hillary Clinton, I think, is the poster child of sort of corporate democratic politics. There are certain issues. I think she is radically superior to whatever the Republicans have put up. But when it comes to militarism and foreign policy, or when it comes to corporate control of the economy and financialization and Wall Street and big money and politics, she's right there. She is right in the middle of it. That's her game. That's her comfort zone. She has been a champion of commercial corporate interests at home and a champion of U.S. militarism abroad throughout her career. That's who she is. So she's hardly in advance. And only when compared to someone who is those things and then also homophobic and misogynistic or whatever else the Republicans will drag up does she compare favorably. But for someone to view her in the same context, even of what the Democratic Party has put up in the past of Franklin Roosevelt or George McGovern as a candidate, she's not remotely close to them in terms of what she stands for or remotely close to prospective challengers she might face, like Bernie Sanders, who's giving very serious consideration to running, who I think would offer a genuine alternative to the mainstream consensus of American elite politics.
Which may, of course, be also a sort of allusion back to the Nader campaign of 2000. I mean, Hillary Clinton was on the board at Walmart. Financially, these people are all neoliberals, essentially. They're all viciously capitalistic, pro quote-unquote free market, even though that's highly inaccurate in terms of how it operates. You're tuned to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. We're speaking with author, scholar, Professor Robert McChesney, and his newest book, Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, Media Politics and the Struggle for Post-Capitalist Democracy, can be yours for supporting community radio, free speech radio, by calling 800-439-5732. You can pledge online at kpfa.org. This is the final day of the fund drive here at KPFA for December. And for a $140 pledge, you can get Robert McChesney's book, Blowing the Roof of the 21st Century. We also have a media theme and sort of media democracy theme for our package today. Of course, the Censored 2015 book, Inspiring We the People, is yours for a special pledge of $60. And Project Censored the Movie, Ending the Reign of Junk Food News, which has Noam Chomsky, Howard Zinn, whom we've been referencing here today in our interview with Robert McChesney, Abby Martin. Of course, a lot of us at Project Censored in the film, students, professors, Khalil Bendib, Greg Palace, Cynthia McKinney, Nora Barrows-Friedman, Oliver Stone, so many different voices, including extended interviews with Howard Zinn, never before seen or heard. And you can get all of this, the combo pack for today, for $250. You get Robert McChesney's Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, Censored 2015, Project Censored the Movie. You can certainly have a great media democracy holiday season here by calling 800-439-5732.
This is certainly a very important time to support. This is the last day of our fund drive. Mickey and I have driven down from Sonoma County. We're volunteers, and we love doing this. We're in our fourth anniversary year. We just had our fourth anniversary show, and we're really pleased to offer Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century by Bob McChesney, the PC movie, Project Censored the Movie, and the Project Censored 2015 book, all for a combination of $250 pledge. But it's, you know, it's we're coming on Christmas, we're coming on New Year's, and it's, you know, a lot of times people are thinking, well, I just need to read some good books. And here, this is really an opportunity, not only to support community radio, not only to support KPFA, to really value this system, which you often listen to every day, but to also pick up Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, a wonderful read. I went through it this week, incredibly important, and we really recommend it. So call right now, 1-800-439-5732. You can do that online at kpfa.org, and we really ask you to participate. Bob, would you like to say a few words?
Well, you know, I travel around a lot, give lots of talks, and I'm in Berkeley or the Bay Area. I always go to KPFA. And you really notice when you're in a community that has a community radio station that makes a big difference in the culture. And when you've got a great community radio station like KPFA, which is also the crown jewel of the Bay Area in a lot of respects, it just changes the culture for the better. And I look at community radio stations like this and also programs like the Project Censored Show as sort of our lifelines to sanity. And when there's, you know, government spying, when there's a police brutality case, when there's yet another war breaking out or a drone attack somewhere, or where there's an economic crisis, you know, this is a place you go where you're going to get the sort of straight talk, where you're going to really get to the bottom of it, where the, you know, where people in power are going to be called to the carpet to answer for what they do, and it's going to be explained. And I don't know what I'd do without the community radio, and I bet if you're listening to this show, you feel the same way. Well, here's the other part of the story. Only 10% of the regular listeners of this show or to the station actually contribute to support the station or the show. Only 10%. And I suspect some of those 10% are listening right now. If you're one of the 10%, I love you. If I was with you, I'd give you a big hug and a wet kiss. If you're one of the 90%, though, who's not giving but is listening to this right now, you know, you got to go take a look in the mirror. I mean, you got to really think about your program. Maybe you don't have much money or hardly at all, but you can give something. Maybe it's just a dollar or two or $5. Give whatever you can. If you can give 10 or 20, so much the better. 140, you get a copy of my book. But you can give something. If everyone just gave a little, if we got that 10% figure up 15 or 20%, it would be a difference of night and day for the quality of what could be done in community radio here in the Bay Area. And something else, I know there's the Bay Area's got some people who are doing really well, that life has treated them well, they've had a lot of success. If you can give $1,000 or $10,000, do it, because there are a lot of people out there who can't give anything and wish they could. there's a special burden on those of us who've been blessed with more to reach out and support our brothers and sisters. This is your time. Support the station. Support the show. Call. Make your pledge immediately.
Yeah, the number is 800-439-5732. That's 800-439-5732. And this is Community Free Speech Radio, and we have a community of people in the phone room that are there to take your pledge. They are happily there to take down your information, getting Blowing the Roof of the 21st Century by Robert McChesney for a $140 pledge. Censored 2015, Inspiring We the People for a special discounted $60 pledge. That's $5 a month, folks. And Ralph Nader did the foreword to that. We've been talking about Ralph Nader in the interview here today as well. Project Censored, the Moving Into the Reign of Junk Food News, discounted at $80 pledge. You can get the combo pack for $250. But, you know, you just heard Robert McChesney say that this is the lifeline. We know people in the KPFA community. We know that we know that you're out there, and we want to hear it from you now. We want to hear you call in. We want to see your support, not just for this kind of programming at the Project Censored Show. You heard my co-host Peter Phillips saying this is our fourth anniversary doing the Project Censored Show. We're now on over 20 stations around the U.S. 800-439-5732 is how you can best thank us by thanking KPFA and Pacifica for providing us a platform. We don't have the megaphones of the 1%. We don't have the CNNs and Foxes and MSNBCs and CBS, NBC, ABC. We don't even have what people may have through NPR, per se. But you're not going to hear the kind of programming that we're doing here at KPFA on any of these other outlets. So call now, 800-439-5732. And I wanted to thank Robert McChesney, not only for his work and his great scholarship and his contributions to our important dialogue on media democracy over the last couple decades, but he's somebody that walks the walk, talks the talk, and it's all in his book, Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century. And you hear him here. He's asking for people to help support this. And Bob had his own radio show for a decade. So he knows what it's like, and he knows the importance of community. And, again, he's willing to put his money where his mouth is. And we appreciate that, and we appreciate the support of people like Robert McChesney. And we need to hear it from you now. 800-439-5732, 800-439-5732, kpfa.org. You can pledge online. Ask for Bob McChesney's new book. Ask for the Project Censored combo. And we would be happy for you to have that. You can support KPFA Free Speech Radio, and you can also share that very vital information with people around you and people in your communities. 800-439-5732. Peter?
We're talking about community-powered radio, and, you know, the power is with the people. And that's like, you know, power to the people. I remember that very well. And we often sign books with that note. And this is where we ask you to support programs like Project Censored Show and KPFA overall. It's a vital part of public information, a vital part of free speech. And the premiums today is a very nice package of media. Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century by Bob McChesney for a $140 pledge. Project Censored the Movie for an $80 pledge. And Project Censored the Book 2015 Yearbook for a $60 pledge, and a total $250 for all three. Wonderful set of both DVD and reading. We're asking for your support. This is the last day of the fund drive. Please call right now, 1-800-439-5732.
We're speaking with Professor Robert McChesney. His newest book is Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century. We'll be right back after this short musical break. Stay with us.
Bob, you write how the Trilateral Commission wrote in the 1970s about the crisis of democracy, which really what they meant was that poor people, young people, women, people of color were getting too involved in the political process. They needed to kind of deal with that in some way. And you're mentioning here massive increase in incarceration. Your book talks about the doubling of civilian government spending for public safety, police, so that there's a repressive side of that, the new Jim Crow that Michelle Alexander writes about. But leading from that, and you're saying that moving to democracy, we absolutely need a vibrant, independent media. Could we talk a little bit about that?
If self-government's going to work, if people are going to have the power to govern their own lives in a political, social environment, a political system, they have to know what they're doing. They have to have information that's reliable, that's credible, so they know what's going on and what the alternatives are. But without that, you can have the right to vote, or you can have the ability to vote. And if you have no idea what's going on or what will happen depending on the outcome of the election, it'll be a pretty meaningless right. So having the information is foundational to a free society being functional. And the news media tend to play that role in most modern advanced societies, any modern society, and they have for a couple of centuries. And that's always been the basis of a lot of my work. It's certainly been the basis for Project Censored and the great work that's been done there. And it's the crisis we face, that we are in a situation now in which the caliber of what we get for news and information is woeful compared to what we need if we're going to understand the world to change it. It's why so many of us, including all three of us, have worked so hard to engage, to criticize the mainstream news media and provide an alternative and have a vision of an alternative system that would be far more suitable to a self-governing society.
Bob, would you agree that this increased repression, police state, is also manifested via the cultural apparatus that Mills talks about in terms of the control of the media and top-down propaganda, deliberate propaganda, to mislead and misinform?
Well, of course. I mean, again, our news media, our commercial news media, going back to the beginning of the sort of latest round of Law and Order in the 60s and 70s and into the 80s, you know, our commercial news media are really not interested in poor people or poor people of color, especially, unless they get in the way of rich people. You know, you don't see feature stories on, gee, how's life going for some, you know, single mom who's working two jobs with three kids, you know, in their lifestyle section of the newspaper or the specials on CNN. The worldview of the people who do news media in the United States is their audience is middle and upper class, and with people disposable income, the people their advertisers want to reach, and issues they pick to cover outside of elite political issues where elites decide what to be covered are going to be sort of how things influence that crowd of the people they see as their readers and their target audience. And as a result, poor people basically don't even show up. They don't factor. And they're just seen as someone to be manipulated, moved around, and hopefully they won't get in the way of everyone else, especially poor people of color, especially black men. And so you have a situation in the United States where we've seen over the last three decades this spectacular increase since the mid-70s in the number of men, especially black men, behind bars in prison, largely for drug crimes. And we have all the evidence that shows that black men do not commit these crimes any more than white men or other people do, but they're arrested at a much greater rate and convicted at a much greater rate. This is all known. Yet it's barely a news story in the United States. It's hardly covered. When Michelle Alexander's new Jim Crow book came out, you would have thought that, you know, she had discovered something like Einstein in 1905 coming forward with the theory of relativity. But it was all out there. I mean, I read about the chapter I wrote in this book was written a couple of years before Michelle Alexander's book was published. There's a lot of that data simply off limits because it was of no interest to our mainstream media. Poor people, people of color, are really no interest unless they get in the way of white people. And so they get in the news when you have unarmed black people being shot down by cops in Ferguson or being killed in Staten Island or shot in Cleveland, Ohio, or wherever. They become news when hell is raised, so they create demonstrations and interfere with white people's lives. Then they become a news story. But in and of themselves, if there weren't those demonstrations, if there was that outrage, it would not be a news story, and it normally never is a news story.
We're speaking with Professor Robert McChesney. His most recent book is Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century. And you were talking about mainstream media, or corporate media is usually the way that we're referring to it, but they do dominate and sort of create and guide the so-called mainstream narratives. Of course, they frame history off for their own interests, and the way they cover these events, like you said, when people get into the streets and raise hell, little attention is paid to the injustices that are decried, and much more attention is paid to the fact that this is an inconvenience for the middle, upper middle class. Peter and I, of course, have said for a while that we think that the corporate media is entirely irrelevant other than being a megaphone for the 1% or a medium for the plutocracy. And the media reform movement, I mean, of course, very important endeavors there, particularly with net neutrality, trying to really make sure that some of the communications technologies we have in the 21st century are used to help us achieve a more democratic society. But what do you see, as, and again, your connections with Free Press, freepress.net, duly noted, but you talk a little bit more about a radical media reform, and one, let's argue that some of the reforms that have been looked at, sort of trying to attenuate the FCC, trying to control some of what happens there, those haven't been going so well with people like Tom Wheeler at the controls under Obama. So what do you see both, A, as the limits of this reform, and B, what we should be doing in its stead?
I think the media reform movement, of which I'm part, with Free Press and primarily in the last 10 years, when it was created, the idea was that we would have one foot in Washington and one foot in the country, and we do primarily field work to organize people around radical demands to make upon media policymakers. Then we would go to Washington and raise hell and expand the range of debate and show that there was popular support for far more dramatic and radical shifts in media policy to open up space for nonprofit and non-commercial voices in particular, and also protect net neutrality and a host of other issues. And I think what happened to Free Press is we were far more successful inside the Beltway in the second term of the W. Bush administration than we ever imagined possible, to the point where a lot of what we were working on was embraced rhetorically by Democrats out of power. And so we put, and I still would defend this as not an irrational move, we put a lot of all our chips on that number. And when Obama was elected and had commanding majorities in the House and Senate and would control the FCC, that we would be in a position to get a fairly progressive agenda through the FCC and through Congress. And that didn't happen. We won some stuff, and if we do win net neutrality, which we may well, to some extent it will be because of the commitments we got of President Obama when he was candidate Obama to support net neutrality. But in general, the FCC under Julius Genachowski basically did nothing and didn't want to rock the boat or antagonize the corporate interests. My argument is that things are so corrupt in Washington now, we still fight there, we still fight on net neutrality, but we really need to just get back to the countryside. We need to talk to people about meaningful issues that they can relate to that really go to the great crises we face.
We've been speaking with Professor Robert McChesney about his new book, Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, and Howard Zinn is referenced in it numerous times. Howard Zinn, the late historian, national treasure, was a national judge for Project Censored, very active. One of his more famous lines was, "You can't be neutral on a moving train," and we're not neutral here. We know what side we're on. We're on the side of the people, we the people, and Project Censored filmmakers, Christopher Oscar and Doug Hecker, in the film Project Censored the Movie, Ending the Reign of Junk Food News, they went around interviewing so many wonderful voices around the U.S. Peter Kuznick, Oliver Stone, Michael Pareni, Khalil Ben-Deeb, Sharon Jimenez, Abby Martin, Nora Barrows-Friedman, and Howard Zinn, of course, was one of these people. And we have, as part of the Project Censored DVD that's available for a premium today, we have outtakes from an extended interview that has never been heard before. We have outtakes of that interview. So if you really appreciate the work of people like Howard Zinn, this is a great opportunity for you to get access to this interview. It's in part of Project Censored the Movie. So let's listen now. We'll share with you an excerpt from that extended interview with Howard Zinn for Project Censored the Movie.
In your recent book titled Just War, you talk about the difference between wars like World War II, the Civil War, and the Revolutionary War, compared to the wars of the past 40 years, like Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq. Talk to us a little bit about Just War.
Yeah, it's interesting that I single out those three wars, the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, World War II. I call them the Holy Wars. They are the wars that are unquestioned. And people are willing to question the Mexican War, the Spanish-American War, you know, the Vietnam War. And, of course, more and more people have questioned the war in Iraq. But those three wars are just sacrosanct. And my first poke at this idea of just war was in dealing with World War II, and I suppose one reason that was my first foray into this difficult area is that I was in the war, And I had been an enthusiastic bombardier in the war, but then came out of the war and began to think. You don't think when you're in the military. You are doing your job. You have persuaded yourself that you are on the good side, and that there's an absolutely polar distinction between you on the good side and the enemy. But I realized after the war that this was a sort of psychological trick, that if the other guys are bad, and the other guys very often are bad, and in the case of World War II, they were very bad. They were fascists, Germany, Japan, Italy. But the psychological trick is that the other side being bad must make you good. No, it isn't that way, because war corrupts everybody. If they aren't corrupt at the beginning of the war, they soon become corrupt. And I was aware of the history of the Peloponnesian Wars way back in ancient Greece, where the Athenians go to war against the Spartans, and the Spartans are the fascists of their time, the bad guys. And the Athenians, presumably, representing democracy. In fact, people still talk about democratic Athens, democratic Greece. Not quite so. Slaves a lot of reasons not to call it democratic. But the Athenians, when they go to war against the Spartans, soon begin acting with enormous cruelty. Well, this is what happens in World War II. We go to war against the Nazis, and they've been bombing civilian populations in Rotterdam and London, and we denounce that. They are bad, killing civilians, and soon we are bombing civilians, and on a much greater scale, in fact, than the Nazis. By the end of World War II, we had probably killed about 600,000 German civilians, probably an equal number in Japan. And in Japan, people know about Hiroshima and Nagasaki, although I must say they don't really know about Hiroshima and Nagasaki, in the sense that hardly anybody knows in the profound sense what it is like to be bombed, to live under bombing, what bombing does to human beings. I certainly didn't know, even though I was dropping the bombs. I had no idea what I was doing to people below. I was dropping bombs from 30,000 feet high, 6 miles. I saw no human beings. I could see no blood. Saw no kids' limbs torn off. A very sanitary operation. And so, this is true generally in modern war. Most modern war is waged at a distance. The enemy is abstract. And so the most terrible cruelties go on without people being keenly aware. Well, at the end of World War II, I read about Hiroshima and Nagasaki. I read the dispatches of John Hersey, a great journalist, who wrote about interviewing the survivors of Hiroshima and what that was like and what they had to report. And suddenly it was brought home to me what my bombs had done. I came to the conclusion that war corrupts everybody, war poisons everybody, and that there's no such thing as a just war. No matter what the enemy is like, Saddam Hussein or Ho Chi Minh, they are very useful symbols for governments wanting to mobilize populations for war and persuade these populations that they're doing something moral and just. And so they point to the enemy, and the enemy is often not good. But they use that enemy or the crimes of the enemy, or the whatever is wrong with the enemy, the tyranny of the enemy, they use that to justify the mass killing of people in war and bombing. So, yes, I came to the conclusion that World War II, the good war, the just war, needs to be scrutinized. In fact, Studs Terkel, when he did his oral history of World War II, which he called the good war, was urged by his wife to put quotation marks around the good war, because she read the testimony of the people in his book. And when she read that testimony, she realized, no, it wasn't simply a good war. So I've been talking about that war, writing about it. And now I actually hope to extend my investigation to the Civil War and the Revolutionary War, two other holy wars.
Let's hear more excerpts from that special interview with Howard Zinn as part of Project Censored, the movie.
Have you ever been personally affected by media censorship?
Personally affected by media censorship? By ignoring me. Censorship by, yeah. Well, let's put it this way. I have not been asked to appear on any major news network. I'm trying to think of, well, they've been marginal appearance that I think MSNBC once had me on. Now, you go to the left spectrum of the major media. The left spectrum is what? PBS. The Lehrer NewsHour, right? They're presumably in the progressive end of the spectrum, which is a very sad thing to observe. Well, the Lehrer NewsHour, their idea of a spectrum of opinion is from the National Review on the right to the New Republic on the left. Anything beyond that, no. Once they had me on, many years ago, for about 3 minutes. I think once they had Noam Chomsky on, again, for about 3 minutes. Once they called me to ask me if I would be on their program. They were going to do a program because the Soviet Union had just collapsed. And they want to have a program on what is the future of socialism. They thought, well, yes, I'm the one to ask. So they call me. They do what is called a pre-interview. I love what these people do. They don't trust themselves. They don't trust that they're in control of the media. And they want to pre-interview you to make sure that you're going to say what they want you to say. So they pre-interview me for the Lehrer NewsHour. Well, what do you think of the collapse of the Soviet Union and what this bodes for the future of socialism? I said, well, I think this is a great thing for the future of socialism. I think the Soviet Union got in the way. It was an obstacle. It distorted people's notion of what socialism is. Maybe now we can get back to a more rational view of socialism, a socialism that in this country reached several million people in the beginning of the 20th century. Socialism of Eugene Debs and Emma Goldman and Clarence Darrow and Upton Sinclair. So, yes, I think this is a great opportunity for socialism. Well, I never heard from them again. And then I tuned in on the program where they discussed that. And who did they have instead of me? That James Weinstein, who's the editor of, In These Times. And it was presumably a socialist. I say presumably because what was his attitude? Oh, well, this is terrible. The Soviet Union has collapsed. You know, he was really mimicking what everybody else was saying. It proves that Marxism is dead. Well, anyway, these are my few experiences, you know, with the media. And what part of the media interview me? You know, the independent media, Democracy Now!, David Barsamian, KPFA and KPFK. And that's about it.
That was an outtake of an interview with Howard Zinn for Project Censored, the movie. Of course, Howard Zinn is included in the film along with people like Noam Chomsky, Daniel Ellsberg, Greg Palast, many professors and students involved in Project Censored. And Zinn was a national judge, author, of course, of People's History of the United States, among many books. And Howard Zinn said, quote, "The systematic exposure of censored stories by Project Censored has been an important contribution." And we certainly appreciated the work that Howard did over the years and certainly the work he did supporting Project Censored. And we're asking you now to help support not just the work of Project Censored, but stand with people like Howard Zinn and support this kind of programming, free speech programming, and community radio at KPFA Pacifica Radio. You can do that right now by calling 800-439-5732, kpfa.org online, or call 800-439-5732. For an $80 pledge, you get Project Censored the Movie, Ending the Reign of Junk Food News, with the outtakes, including the full Howard Zinn interview. You get Censored 2015, Inspiring We the People, with a foreword by Ralph Nader, cartoons by Khalil Bendib, certainly a familiar name for people in the KPFA audience. $60 pledge. Blowing the Roof of the 21st Century, Robert McChesney's newest book, a prolific author, a great thinker. So honored to have Robert McChesney with us here today, and Monthly Review Press was able to give us a decent price on that book. We can offer Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century for $140. Combo, you get everything from today's show for $250, but you only get it by calling 800-439-5732. This is the time for you to step up and not be neutral on the moving train. The train is moving, folks. The train is moving. Peter and I are on it. We know where we're going. We're going in the arc of justice. We're heading in the side that supports free speech, that does not allow for censorship. We're also pointing out that, you know, corporate news media feeds people this top-down propaganda. Part of the reason over half the people in the United States, when recently polled, supported the use of torture and said that the events of 9/11 justified these euphemistic, extraordinary rendition and enhanced interrogation techniques, that's a direct result of mis and disinformation going out to the public that we counter here on the Project Censored show. And we think people need to know more about the facts, more about what international law actually says about torture. And again, you're not going to hear this kind of news and information, fact-based information, on these other news outlets. You're going to hear it here at Pacifica, here at KPFA, here on the Project Censored show. So call in right now in support of the right to know, the right to free speech. Please dial 800-439-5732, 800-439-5732, kpfa.org online. Peter?
We are a community-powered radio station, and that's vitally important. And this is the second week of our fund drive. We're wrapping up today. We need your help. And as you know, over the past 2 weeks, there's been protests all over the country, in the streets, all over in New York and Oakland, and we've been covering that. Despite doing the fund drive last Saturday, we had a two-hour special, 9 to 11, on the march in Washington, D.C., where the stage was stormed by protesters from Ferguson. KBFA did special coverage all that day on New York, D.C., Oakland, Berkeley, San Francisco marches and what was going on. Mitch Jesuris, Sabrina Jacobs, Velma Ortiz, Chris Welsh, Davey D., Cameron Jones, Dennis Bernstein, they were all out there. They were all covering that, the actions that were happening. Flashpoints did a great show on Saturday on the coverage in Oakland. Anita Johnson was out in the rain on Monday morning covering the nonviolent actions that were in the streets in Oakland. This is the special kind of coverage we offer, and we think it's vitally important that you support this, that you know what's going on. And we really ask you to call right now, 1-800-439-5732, for our media package today for Project Censored. $250 pledge gets you all three items, the Blowing the Roof Off, the 21st Century book, PC the movie, or PC the book, 2015, all available and ready for to take your pledge, your call right now, the last day of Fund Drive. We need your help. And a reminder, too, that we're going to be out at the Crafts Fair in Richmond this weekend on Saturday and Sunday from 10 to 5. And we hope to see everybody out there. That's the KPFA Crafts Fair in Richmond, 10 to 5 this weekend.
That's right. And, you know, you can come and see folks from Project Censored Show. You can see a lot of other folks here from KPFA. It's the weekend before, you know, the holidays and so forth. But this is a great place to go and continue to support KPFA Community Radio at that Crafts Fair this weekend in Richmond on the pier. But right now, we'd like to see your support more immediately by calling 800-439-5732. 800-439-5732 is the number to call. Online, kpfa.org. Please make that call. We have some amazing thank you gifts for your support of Free Speech Radio, Blowing the Roof of the 21st Century, Bob McChesney's newest book, $140 pledge, Project Censored, The Moving Ending, The Reign of Junk Food News, $80 pledge, and that includes the excerpt that we had here from Howard Zinn. It includes the extra materials. That's an $80 pledge for Project Censored, the movie, and also Censored 2015 by Andy Lee Roth, myself, the team at Project Censored. So many wonderful faculty, 260 students, 50 faculty, including Susan Rahman, Nolan Higdon, so many people part of the Project Censored family putting together this annual book by Seven Stories Press. Only a $60 pledge, folks. That's $5 a month. Inspiring we the people. Inspire Peter and I right now. Call 800-439-5732. 800-439-5732 is the number to call. And I wanted to thank everybody that's been calling in. Thank everybody for your support, not only of KPFA on this last day of the fund drive, but I also wanted to thank our special supporters here at KPFA for Peter and I. That would be Anthony Fest, our intrepid producer. This is coming into our fourth year now, and we couldn't do what we do without the help of people like Anthony Fest. Erica Bridgman is our engineer, and we're very, very appreciative of all the people that helped make this program possible. And we want to thank all of you, the listeners, who make this possible. And if you can make that donation, that end-of-year donation to Pacifica, to KPFA, you'll get our gratitude and you'll get our great thanks. 800-439-5732 is the number to call. 800-439-5732. That is the number, kpfa.org. Thank you so much for your support. I'm Mickey Huff, along with Peter Phillips. This is the Project Censored Show on KPFA Pacifica Radio. Peter, you and I have been coming down here for almost 4 years now, and we, well, for 4 years this week, and again, we'd love to see the support pouring in on the phone lines. 800-439-5732 is the number to call. We've got amazing premiums and gifts for people that are calling in. Bob McChesney's new book, Blowing the Roof Off the 21st Century, Project Censored, the movie that has the footage of Howard Zinn, Project Censored 2015, the book, Inspiring We the People. We'd like it if you'd inspire us by calling 800-439-5732. Peter?
We think it's really important to come and do this. Community radio, this 59,000 watt station covers the entire Bay Area down to Santa Cruz, over to Fresno, up the North Coast. We really love having that voice, that megaphone, to talk about these very important issues that Project Censored has been researching now for 38 years. We think that's some vital information. It's important for people to be aware of, and we ask for your support. Mickey and I drive down here from Sonoma County. We're completely volunteer. It costs the station zero to have us involved and do this program, other than the overhead costs that the station requires. And that's where you have to come in. That's where we need you to think about contributing, like $5 a week. I mean, this is a cup of coffee, folks. This is what keep this station alive. And we need the 90% of you who haven't ever contributed to really think about becoming a member for $25, picking up one of these books, the Project Censored 2015, your book for a $60 pledge. That's $5 a month. You can spread it out like that and really be involved and say, yes, I support community radio. I support this kind of information. I support public information being out so that we can think about building democracy and not allow that police state that Bob McChesney talks about to rule over us, not allow the state of media to completely keep us in the dark, to simply make an entertainment mechanism instead of a thought mechanism. We ask you to think, join with us, be proud of KPFA, be proud of your own mind and the importance of having this kind of intellectual stimulation on a daily basis is vital to being a full human being.
That's right, people, and we can really use your support right now. 800-439-5732 is the number to call to help us end the reign of junk food news here at the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. Your pledge goes a long way, not just in getting more information out to the public, whether it's through these kinds of programs or through the premiums we're offering today, but it also helps keep the station alive, and it helps you get information you need to share with people in your community. That's why this is community-sponsored radio. 800-439-5732 is the number to call. Keep the calls coming. 800-439-5732. Pledge securely online at kpfa.org. We thank you for your support.
We won. human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians. Cause they own by special interests, who said fund their campaign. It's why you hear the same old things they claim, but change never came. It's a dirty game maintained by rain for capital gain.
That's our program for today. Thanks for joining us. The Project Censored Show airs on 20 stations around the U.S. For more information and to listen to archives of previous shows, go to www.projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook. Anthony Fest is our producer, Erica Bridgman, our engineer. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. We'll see you next time. Stay tuned for Terra Verde.
When you make contributions to the organizations that are...
As a KPFA listener, you're probably well aware that this station is reliant on you to fund this community service. But it's not just about the dollars. It's the number of people who participate that's equally important. So no matter how much you can give, we hope...